Aditya Surte is a qualified BCom ACA. He's also been assisting Shri PV Surte, advocate on MBAT matters since 2011 and a practicing CA since 2016, mainly focusing on indirect taxes. He regularly delivers lectures on GST at seminars organized by various professional and trade organizations and conducts training for CA firms and corporate houses. He is also visiting faculty at the Management Development Program of Wellingkar Institute, Matunga. He acts as a consultant to various corporations and business entities on matters relating to GST. Something on awards and recognition. He has been awarded as the best upcoming speaker 2016 by AIFTP in December 16. He has been awarded as the best paper writer for presenting technical paper on case studies in composite and mixed supply at the 42nd Residential Refreshional Course of GSTPM. Few publications. Articles in Sales Tax Review published by GSTPM and the Chamber Journal. Short publication on transition provisions in GST by GSTPM. Key rulings under indirect taxes laws, GST perspective by Chambers. He is also a conveyor of Law and Representation Committee of GSTPM for the year 1920. He is also a member of the Managing Committee of the West Zone of AIFTP for the year 1920. He is selected as a training faculty by Institute of Chartered Accountants for training on GST. His other interests are deeply enjoys light, semi-classic and classical music. With this introduction, I request Aditya to take over the charge for online seminar. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Sujay, for that kind introduction. I welcome all of you to today's session of learning. Before we begin, I wish to convey two or three things. Firstly, I am not at my residence. I'm in Talegaon, so I am streaming this using the 4G of my phone. So we have tested it. It is functioning fine. However, there are instances where the connection drops and then it comes back. It happened while Sujay was introducing me as well. So it is not dropping my link to this. To bring it to my attention through phone or by me, is everyone able to see the PPT? Mahesh?
Yeah, we can see you the PPT. No problem. You can carry
on. All right. So we'll begin. As I said, I welcome all of you. I want to commend the efforts of the association to take up this task of, walking into the future by conducting online sessions of learning. And I want to commend all of you as well that you have chosen to devote your time to learn. This is the future of learning. Nowadays, we are all seeing that all the online coaching courses are coming up. Today's session is on place of supply of goods as well as services. Now, usually, if I was asked how much time would I require for this topic, I would say I will require at least 2 to 3 hours. However, the time given to us today is limited. We will cover the entire part as much as possible. So the place of supply that I usually conduct, I try to keep it as interactive as possible. However, given the constraints that we have, interaction as we usually have will not be possible. I still have a lot of examples. I will answer those. You can answer those in the chat. I will share this PPT in the chat window once we are done with this session. So there is no need for you to, take screenshots or any such things. So let us come to the subject. We are studying today place of supply of goods and services. I'm sure almost all of you who are attending today's session have some knowledge about GST. You may have certain idea about place of supply. However, when we conduct any subject in coaching class, we do ensure that we cover the basics. So even if you have never learned place of supply, my intention of today's session is that at the end of this session, you will have a good idea about what is place of supply under GST and why is it required or why is it placed in the law, how to use it. There are a lot of controversial issues as well with regard to place of supply, but I'm afraid that this is not the forum to take up the controversial issues because this is coaching class. Here we cover the provisions of the law. There are certain issues which I will discuss, but I don't think there will be a lot of scope for discussion of issues. At the end of the session, we can cover question answers, if any. So, why do we need place of supply of goods and services in the first place? Everybody is aware that GST in India is a dual GST. We have a dual structure of Indian GST. What that means is that the center and the states simultaneously levy tax on a common tax base. We all have seen that if the value of the goods or services is rupees 100 and the rate of tax is 18%, locally when they are supplied, you have 9% CGST and 9% SGST. CGST is central GST, SGST is state GST. So how does this work? It states that on intrastate supplies, the center will levy CGST and state will levy SGST. And on interstate supplies, the center will levy IGST. Section 7 and Section 8 of the IGST Act deal with determination of nature of supply. What this means is that in order to know which tax we are supposed to levy, whether IGST or CGST and SGST, we need to know first what is the nature of this supply, whether it is an interstate supply or an intrastate supply. Section 7 of the IGST Act states that where the location of supplier and the place of supply are in two different states or two different union territories or a state and a union territory, then that supply will be known as an interstate supply. Section 8 of the IGST Act deals with intrastate supply, and it says where location of supplier and place of supplier in the same state or same union territory, then it will be known as an intrastate supply. And as we all saw, there will be a CGST and SGST on it. So I hope everyone is clear by now. The main purpose of determining the place of supply is to know which tax we are supposed to charge, whether IGST or CGST and SGST. Place of supply by itself does not tell you anything. When combined with location of supplier of the goods or services, it will tell you whether it is an interstate supply or an intrastate supply, and then you will charge the correct tax. As we have seen in Section 7 and Section 8, it is speaking about location of supplier and place of supply. I call these the two limbs of determination of nature of supply. In Marathi, we call it Don Avayav. So these two limbs, if I were to tell you technically to implement how place of supply works, the law says that you first identify the location of supplier. There are provisions for that. Then you identify place of supply. There are provisions for that. Once you have identified these two aspects or these two limbs, then you ask a question whether these two are in the same state or union territory. If the answer is yes, they are in the same state or union territory, the supply is an intrastate supply, you charge CGST and SGST. If the answer to the question whether they are in the same state or union territory is no, which means that they are in two different states or union territories, then it's an interstate supply, you will have to charge IGST. I hope everyone is clear to this point. Now we come to the first limb of location of supplier. The location of supplier of goods has not been defined in the Act. Location of supplier of services has been defined. Why location of supplier of goods has not been defined? in its wisdom, the legislature, while enacting the law, has not made any provision for location of supplier of goods. Is it a mistake? No, I do not think that it's a mistake. If you consider the nature of goods, goods are tangible. If you are a manufacturer, you have a factory, you are supplying those goods from the factory, you will have the factory registered, the place of the factory, and wherever you are supplying those goods from, that will be the location of supplier of goods. Similarly, if you have a warehouse and you're supplying those goods from a warehouse, the location of the warehouse will be the location of supplier of goods. As you all are aware, every supplier of goods has to register each place of business, be it a shop or a factory or a warehouse. He must incorporate those in his registration certificate, and that place will be the location of supplier of goods. Why did they have to define location of supplier of services? Because services are intangible. Therefore, you need to define what exactly is the location of supplier of services. First, where the supply is made from a place of business for which registration has been obtained by the supplier of service, then the location of such place of business is the place of supply. Where supply is made from a place other than the registered place of business, that is a fixed establishment. Mind you, fixed establishment has also been defined in the law. However, our topic for today is not the location of supplier of services. However, it is required, so I'm covering this. So where it is supplied not from a registered place of business, but a fixed establishment, that is a place which is characterized by sufficient degree of permanence in terms of human and technical resources, then the location of such fixed establishment is the place of supply of service. The location of supplier of services. Place of supply is made from more than one place, whether place of business or fixed establishment. The location of most directly concerned with the provision of supply will be the location of supplier of service. And in absence of any such places, the usual place of residence of the supplier. Now, when we come to the aspect of place of supply of services, we will discuss this in a little bit more detail. Till then, we will leave this aside and we will proceed to place of supply of goods. Now, the provisions relating to place of supply in order to determine the place of supply are contained in the IGST Act. So section 10 of the IGST Act deals with place of supply of goods in case of domestic transactions. Section 11 deals with international transactions, that is import and export of goods. Section 12 of the IGST Act deals with domestic transactions of services, and Section 13 deals with place of supply of services in relation to international transactions of services. Place of supply of goods. Now, this chart will give you an overview. Out of this, only a certain aspect I am discussing in detail. The rest are pretty much self-explanatory. So I am leaving myself some time to deal with place of supply of services instead. Section 10 says, place of supply of goods other than import or export, where supply involves movement of goods, then the general rule is that the place of supply will be the location where the movement of goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. Where movement of goods is at the instance of a third party, then the provision says that the place of supply is the principal place of business of the third party. We will discuss this in detail in the next two slides. Then it goes on to say that where there is no movement of goods involved, then the place of supply will be location of goods at the time of their delivery. Place of supply in case of goods which require installation or assembly at site, the place of supply will be the place of such installation or assembly. Where the goods are supplied on board a conveyance, then the place of supply will be location where the goods are actually taken on board. And where it cannot be determined in terms of any of these provisions, then the place of supply will be determined in such manner as may be prescribed. Now, The first part of relating to movement of goods, I am covering in the next two slides. All the others, I will just give one example for each and move on so that you understand this better. So where movement of goods is not involved, it says the place of supply will be location of goods at the time of delivery. Let us say that I have a warehouse in Gujarat where my goods are lying. I am situated in Mumbai. I have registration in Mumbai. Of course, I also have a registration in Gujarat. Now I am dealing with a person who is also in Mumbai. Let's say that I sell those goods. It's a constructive delivery. I only hand over the key to the warehouse. The goods are sold. Now, is there any movement of goods involved in this supply? No, the goods remain where they are. However, supply has taken place. Now, location of supplier is a different aspect. This provision is determining what is the place of supply. The place of supply is location of goods at the time of delivery. The goods are lying in a warehouse in Gujarat. Therefore, the place of supply of such transaction will be Gujarat. Next, installation or assembly at site. Let us take an example where any machinery has to be installed at site. In that case, the place of supply is the place of actual installation or assembly. Now, goods that are supplied on board a conveyance, let us not take the example of food because that is a controversial matter. If any souvenirs, let's take a case of a cruise or any airline where certain goods are sold. In that case, if a flight is taking off from Mumbai, it is landing at Delhi, and then further it is going to London. And from Delhi to London, certain goods are being sold. Let's say perfumes are being sold or whatever. In that case, the provision states that the place of supply of such goods or such transaction or such supply will be Delhi. This is assuming that the goods were taken on board in Delhi and then the flight took off. Now, how does this make a difference? Supplier of goods, let's say that it's the airline, and the place of supply. So if the airline is registered in Delhi and the goods are sold in its flight flying from Delhi to London, what tax will they charge when they sell those goods? Irrespective of where the flight is when the sale actually takes place, the law says that the location of supplier is Delhi. The place of supply is where the goods were taken on board. That is also Delhi. That is why it will be CGST and SGST of Delhi. I hope this is clear. We move to the movement of goods involved part. Now, where section 10(1)(a) says where the supply involves movement of goods, whether by the supplier or the recipient or any other person, the place of supply of goods shall be the location of the goods at the time at which the movement of goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. An illustration of this is Mr. M supplies goods from Mumbai by way of sale to B of Bangalore, what we call as a sale simplicitor. I received an order from Bangalore. I am situated in Mumbai. I send those goods to my customer in Bangalore, however, by courier or by transport or any such thing. Then the supply by M to B will involve movement from the state of Maharashtra to the state of Karnataka. In this case, this provision states that the place of supply of goods shall be Karnataka, where movement of goods actually terminates for delivery to the recipient B. What will this mean is that location of supplier of goods is Maharashtra. The place of supply will be Bangalore. And that is why the transaction will be an interstate supply liable to IGST. This is one aspect of it. One controversy in this provision is that, let's take an example of M of Mumbai has a warehouse at Bhiwandi. Now, B of Bangalore wants to purchase goods from M. However, the contract states that he will take delivery at Bhiwandi. So B of Bangalore comes to Bhiwandi, takes the delivery of the goods, and then goes back to Karnataka. The question is, which tax should M charge? whether he should charge CGST, SGST, considering the supply as an intrastate supply, or IGST, considering the supply as an interstate supply. If you look at the provisions of the law and read them in harmony with the Sale of Goods Act, the law says, the provision states that the place of supply shall be where the movement of goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. In my opinion, where B of Bangalore comes to my warehouse and then takes the goods back to Bangalore, the delivery has ended at Bhiwandi itself and I should charge CGST and SGST. The problem here is, many of you who are practicing may also be encountering this difficulty. Your client says that if I charge him CGST and SGST, obviously he will not get the credit because he's not registered in Maharashtra, he's registered in Karnataka. If I do not charge IGST, he'll go to somebody else who is charging IGST. Does that mean that you should start charging IGST? The answer is no. Can you take certain precautions so that he can charge IGST? Yes. You must ensure that the delivery is made in Karnataka in order to charge IGST. Now, there are huge conglomerates who I know are charging IGST, even in this case. And that is why this question is cropping up. If you ask me the question, strictly from the point of view of law, M should charge CGST and SGST and not IGST. The question that you should always ask in such cases, which I always ask, if you want to charge IGST, when B takes the goods back from Bhiwandi to Karnataka, is the movement in your control? He may take it to Karnataka, he may take it to Pune, he may take it to any other place and sell those goods also. So that is not in my hand. Secondly, if something happens to those goods on their way to Karnataka, who is responsible? Is M responsible or is B responsible? Who will bear the loss? If the answer is that it is the responsibility of M till the goods reach Karnataka, then obviously the delivery has not yet been completed. The risk and reward in the goods have not been passed to M, to B. However, if the answer is that once I deliver those goods, it is his headache, it is not my responsibility what happens to those goods, then by all means, the delivery has ended. There are two views in this regard. My job today is to make you aware of the provisions and the controversies. Let us move on. Section 10.1b states that where the goods are delivered by the supplier to a recipient or any other person on the direction of a third person, whether acting as an agent or otherwise, before or during movement of goods, either by way of transfer of documents or otherwise, it shall be deemed that the said third person has received the goods and the place of supply of such goods shall be the principal place of business of such person. This supply is what we knew as a 6-2 transaction under the CST Act. Let's take an illustration and quickly understand this provision and move on. M of Mumbai requests A of Ahmedabad to deliver goods to B of Bangalore. We all come across such provisions. Your client says that I have received an order from somebody in Ahmedabad and he wants me to deliver the goods to Bangalore straight away, who is his customer. In this situation, the place of supply shall be the principal place of business of M of Mumbai for A of Ahmedabad. Let's understand this. B of Bangalore has placed an order on M of Mumbai. M of Mumbai in turn placed an order on A of Ahmedabad to deliver the goods at Bangalore. Now, A delivers those goods to Bangalore. There are two limbs of this transaction. There are two transactions taking place here. Firstly, there is transaction B. I am calling it transaction B. That is the transaction between the supplier and the third person. The third person is a person who is giving instructions to somebody else to deliver those goods. This transaction falls under section 10.1b, and in this case, the law says the place of supply will be the place of supply, the principal place of business of M of Mumbai. Transaction A between M and B will be covered by section 10(1)(a), and the law says the place of supply is the place where movement of goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. We already saw 10(1)(a). Now, in transaction B, we already saw the place of supply is going to be Maharashtra, and in the transaction A, the place of supply will be Karnataka. When a bill is raised by A of Ahmedabad on M of Mumbai for the supply that he made to M and delivery was made, this is a bill to ship to transaction, he will charge IGST. Why? Because location of supplier of goods is Gujarat and place of supply by virtue of 10(1)(b) is the principal place of business of the third person, that is Maharashtra. So location of supplier is Gujarat, place of supply is Maharashtra, therefore IGST. Next, when M of Mumbai raises an invoice on B of Bangalore, this transaction is covered by 10(1)(a), where there is movement of goods involved. The place of supply will be the place where the movement of goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. The movement terminated for delivery at Bangalore in Karnataka. The location of supplier is Maharashtra. The place of supply is Karnataka. Therefore, this will be an interstate supply liable to IGST. Let's change this scenario a little bit so that you understand this concept fully. In this case, B of Bangalore has placed an order on M of Mumbai. In turn, M of Mumbai places an order on P of Pune to deliver the goods to B of Bangalore. Accordingly, P delivers the goods, bill to ship to transaction again. Now, when P raises an invoice on M of Mumbai, this will be location of supplier of goods will be Maharashtra. Although the goods have moved to Bangalore, by virtue of 10(1)(b), the place of supply of this transaction is the principal place of business of the third person, that is Mumbai, that is Maharashtra. Since location of supplier and place of supply are both in Maharashtra, therefore he will charge CGST and SGST. What about the transaction between M and B? When M of Mumbai raises an invoice on B of Bangalore for the supply of goods, there has been a movement of goods. The movement of goods has terminated for delivery at Karnataka. Therefore, place of location of supplier Maharashtra, place of supply Karnataka, therefore IGST. I hope everyone is clear with this. We move on to section 11, place of supply of goods imported. It simply states that goods imported into India, the place of supply will be location of importer. Where the goods are exported from India, the place of supply will be the location outside India, wherever the goods are sent. We come to the larger section of our presentation, the place of supply of services. Mind you, place of supply of services is much larger than place of supply of goods. At this point, I would like to ask Mahesh, if till now everything is going smoothly, is my internet connection also holding us up?
Absolutely. Going on well.
Okay.
Absolutely. Right.
All right.
All are muted. All right. Are muted.
Yes, yeah. I understand.
Yeah.
Let us move ahead. Mahesh, I have closed my chat window because otherwise I am not able to see my presentation. So you will have to keep track of the comments.
Okay. Don't worry. I will let you know.
The chat window at the end of my session.
Yeah. I will let you know.
We are moving on to place of supply of services. Place of supply of services is covered under section 12 and section 13 of the IGST Act. Section 12 states that the provisions of section 12 will be applied where the location of supplier and location of recipient of services in India. Somebody's mic is on. Mahesh, yours, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So that is why we are calling this section as the section which deals with domestic supply of services, where both location of supplier and location of recipient is in India. Now, I would like to go back quickly to this definition that we saw of location of supplier of services. This is where this assumes significance. Please bear in mind for location of recipient of services, it is exactly the same. Now, why do you need to identify the location of services? For two aspects. First, we already saw, in order to determine the nature of supply. In order to determine, I think my internet connection had gone for some time. I will just skip 5 seconds, go back 5 seconds and begin this again. Why location of supplier of services and location of recipient of services is important? There are identical definitions. Location of supplier of services is important for two things. One, we already saw that we need to identify location of supplier to identify what is the nature of supply, whether interstate or intrastate, in combination with place of supply. Secondly, you need to identify the location of supplier of service and the location of recipient of service to understand which section you are going to look at to identify place of supply. Once you identify the location of supplier and recipient, if both of them are in India, then you will go to section 12. If either of these two is outside India, you will have to go to section 13 and then determine place of supply. So let's take my case. I am a chartered accountant. I have my registered place of business in Mumbai. Therefore, and I am supplying chartered accountancy service place of business, then any supply made from a place of business for which registration has been obtained, then the location of such place of business. So that will be my location. So I am in India. If all those people who I am supplying my services to are also registered under GST, then where the services are received at a registered place of business, then the location of such registered place of business will be the location of recipient. So this is the simple case. With this understanding, let us move on for identification of place of supply of services. Most of our members of the Goods and Services Tax Practitioners Association of Maharashtra, which was previously the Sales Tax Practitioners, are practitioners dealing with goods. So understanding supply, place of supply of goods is fairly easier for us. Place of supply of services is sometimes a little new and it takes us some unlearning and some learning. Now, if you look at the provisions are pretty logical in my opinion. The general rule for identifying place of supply of services, when we are discussing all these, you must bear in mind that this is under section 12. This only deals with domestic supply of services. Location and location of supplier and recipient are both in India. Where such domestic services are supplied to a registered person, what we usually know as a B2B supply, then the general rule states that the place of supply of such services will be the location of recipient. When such services are supplied to other than a registered person, that is a B2C supply, in that case, the provision state that where address of the recipient exists on record, then the place of supply will still be the location of the recipient. However, where the address of the recipient does not exist on record, then the place of supply will be location of supplier. If I give you one simple example, you will understand this. There is a logic behind this, which I always follow to understand these provisions. While learning place of supply of services, you should always bear this one thing in mind, is that the provisions are designed in such a way that wherever input tax credit is required to be taken, the credit will follow the recipient. That is, that wherever possible, the recipient will be able to claim the credit. Where I am supplying services to a registered person, and if that registered person, let's take, is located in the state of Goa, then if I charge CGST and SGST, so my location is fixed in Maharashtra, if the place of supply falls in Maharashtra, I will have to charge CGST and SGST. Will that person be able to get credit of it if he is not registered in Maharashtra? No. Therefore, ideally, I should be charging IGST and only then he'll be able to take the credit. Now, all those services which are usually taken in the course of business and taken by registered persons, you will find that where the general rule, if it does not fall under any of the specified service, the place of supply will be location of recipient. Therefore, if I provide any services to a person located in Gujarat, the place of supply will be location of recipient. If he is registered, go to the definition of location of recipient of service. It is Goa. Therefore, it is an interstate supply. I will charge IGST and he will be able to claim the credit of it. Now, when I'm supplying services to an unregistered person, a B2C supply, why does the provision still state that I should, where the address exists on record, I should still charge IGST? When they say that the place of supply will be location of recipient, that is in another state, I will be still charging IGST. We all know that GST is a consumption-based tax. Therefore, it's a destination-based tax. It's a consumption-based tax. Therefore, wherever the services are being consumed, ideally, that state should get the revenue. So when I charge IGST and I put the place of supply as Goa, even if the person is not registered and I have his address on record, then the taxes will go to the state of Goa. Where the address does not exist on record, then I have no choice but to consider the place of supply as location of supplier and charge CGST and SGST. This was the general rule. There are certain specified services for which there are specific provisions. I am dealing with each of these in the next slides in detail, so I am not reading these out for you right now. I'm just keeping them in front of you. First, section 12, subsection 3, deals with immovable property related services. Now, the provision states that any services supplied directly in relation to an immovable property, including services provided by architects, interior decorators, surveyors, engineers, other related experts, estate agents, grant of rights to use immovable property, or coordination of construction work, all these services, the place of supply will be location where the immovable property is located or intended to be located. Take one simple example. Take the case of an architect who is registered under GST. He has his office in Mumbai. He is supplying services of drawing up plans for a property which his client is also located in Mumbai, but he intends to build a property in Gujarat. Now, the architect is drawing up the plans for his client who is also based in Mumbai. If you go to the general rule, he would have charged CGST and SGST. But since these are services provided by an architect in relation to an immovable property, and the immovable property is intended to be located in Gujarat, the place of supply will be Gujarat, and he will have to charge IGST and not CGST and SGST. Please bear in mind that although the supplier as well as the recipient are both located in Maharashtra, still the place of supply will be Gujarat, and still the architect will have to charge IGST in his bill. The question then arises is whether the person who is in Mumbai, the recipient of the service, will he be entitled to such IGST credit? The answer is yes, provided all the other conditions of claiming ITC are satisfied. Nothing in the law stops a person from claiming the credit of IGST. Part B of section 12, subsection 3 says lodging accommodation by a hotel in guest house, homestay, club, campsite, houseboat, or any other vessel by whatever name called, the place of supply will be location where such hotel, in guest house, houseboat is located or intended to be located. If I am providing accommodation services, many of you may have come across this problem. that your client wants to claim the credit or has claimed credit. His employee has gone. He is located in Mumbai. His employee has gone to, let's say, Delhi for some work. He stayed in some hotel. All the companies have now given instructions to their employees that you must give your GST number wherever you stay. So he gives the GST number. Now, the hotel in Delhi has still charged CGST and SGST of Delhi. And he is confused as to why they have done this and why, whether I can take the input tax credit of this. Now, location of supplier, if you look at the point of, if you look at it from the point of view of the hotel, where the hotel is located in Delhi, he has his registration in Delhi. So the location of supplier of service is Delhi. Place of supply, by virtue of this provision, 12.3b, where he's providing accommodation services, it specifically states that the location where such hotel is situated, that will be the place of supply. Therefore, his place of supply will always be Delhi. He's registered in Maharashtra, claim the input tax credit of CGST and SGST of Delhi? No, he cannot. Section 12.3c talks about accommodation in any immovable property for arranging any marriage or reception or matters related therewith, or any official, social, cultural, religious, business function, including services provided for such venue, and any services ancillary to the above referred services. The place of support, the common thread, is that where any of such services which are directly or intrinsically linked to an immovable property, the place of supply is stated to be the location of such immovable property. Now, if the location of the immovable property or boat or vessel is located or intended to be located outside India, then they say that the place of supply shall be the location of the recipient. I have taken the same example of the architect. Now, let's say that the architect is based in Mumbai, his client is also based in Mumbai, but instead of Gujarat, he intends to build a property in Dubai and he is drawing up plans for the property in Dubai. Now, if we go by the previous provisions, we'll say that the location of supplier is Maharashtra, the place of supply is Dubai, and therefore we'll say that this is an export of service provided other conditions are satisfied. However, the provisions clearly state that where the immovable property is located or intended to be located outside India, then the place of supply will be location of the recipient. So in such case, the place of supply will be location of recipient, that is also Maharashtra. Therefore, the architect will be charging CGST and SGST and not IGST. The last part of this says that where the immovable property or the boat or vessel is located or situated in more than one state, then you will have to proportionately value or segregate this supply in terms of the contract for each state. Moving on, performance-based services. I am calling these performance-based services. Section 12.4 and 12.5, restaurant and catering services, personal grooming, fitness, beauty treatment, health service, including cosmetic and plastic surgery. The provision states that the place of supply will be location of actual performance. I will give you one example which I have come across, and that will clarify this for you. One person who is a professional makeup artist, or let's say is a personal groomer. Now that person provides services to production houses for doing makeup for their movies. Now the film is being shot at three locations. One is a studio in Mumbai, second is Rajasthan, and third, let's say, is Switzerland. Now the problem that happens is, in this case, the supplier of service is in Mumbai, the studio is also based out of Mumbai. However, the supplier of service cannot charge CGST and SGST simply because both are located in Mumbai, because the nature of service is such that the place of supply has to be determined based on actual performance of the service. Now this person in the current scenario has to raise three invoices: one for the services supplied in Mumbai, for which she will charge CGST and SGST. Second, the location of the place of supply will be Rajasthan, for which she will be required to charge IGST. And third, the services supplied in Switzerland, the place of supply will be out of India, and she will be required to charge IGST. Whether it falls under export of service will depend on whether she receives her remuneration in convertible foreign exchange, and in this case she is not. Therefore, this will not be considered as an export of service. She will have to charge IGST, stating the place of supply as other territory. I am moving on. 12.5, training and performance appraisal service to a registered person, where it's a B2B supply, is somebody's mic on? Yeah. Training and performance appraisal services provided to a registered person, the place of supply is location of recipient. And training and performance appraisal service provided to an unregistered person, the place of supply is location of actual performance. I am providing training services to you. Now, if I were to charge for these services and any of you were registered under GST, then the place of supply of such service would be the location of recipient. And all those of you who are not registered, the location of actual performance, that is my location, wherever I'm conducting this seminar from, would be the place of supply of such service. I'm sorry, I'm having to move on a little faster than my usual pace because we are running short on time. I'm already delayed. It is 7:55. I will request Mahesh to give me 15-20 minutes extra, so that I can cover all the provisions.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Aditya, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Next part is services by way of admission to events or places. Services by way of admission to a cultural, artistic, sporting, scientific, educational or entertainment event, admission to an amusement park, admission to any other place, and services ancillary to above. Now, what this is talking about is admission to any place. The place of supply, they say that the place where such event is held or where such park or any other place is located, that will be the place of supply. All those people who are from Mumbai must all be aware of SL World. Now we'll just take example of SL World to understand this. SL World is an amusement park. The ticket sale that is done by SL World. Now if they only charge for the admission and then they charge separately for each ride, then that the ticket sale will be the service of admission to an amusement park. What will be the place of supply? Irrespective of what the location of recipient is. That means irrespective of where the person comes from and irrespective of whether he is registered or not under GST, the place of supply will always remain where such park is located. That is why it will always be CGST and SGST on the sale of such tickets. Moving on, next service, organization of a cultural, artistic, sporting, scientific, educational or entertainment event, including supply of service in relation to a conference, fair, exhibition, celebration or any similar event, or services ancillary to organization of any of the above events, or assigning sponsorship of any of the above events, where such services are supplied to a registered person, then the place of supply will be location of the recipient. And where such supply is made to an unregistered person, the place of supply will be the place where the event is actually held. Okay, let's take one quick example to understand this. Our association last year had organized RRC at Gandhidham, which is in Gujarat. Now, the association, whether the member is registered or unregistered, we are taking both cases. The association is providing services of organizing an event. Now, as per the provisions, where such services are supplied to an unregistered person, the place of supply will be where the event is actually held, and where when such services are supplied to a registered person, then it will be the location of such recipient. Therefore, while preparing an invoice to an unregistered person, in my opinion, they will have to charge IGST, and where this invoice is made to a registered person, they will have to charge CGST and SGST because the member is registered in Maharashtra. What about the services supplied by the hotel at which all the participants will be put up? That hotel is providing accommodation services to the association. We already saw that in case of accommodation services, the place of supply will always be the location of the immovable property. Therefore, the hotel will always charge CGST and SGST of Gujarat. Now, the question that arises is that can the association, which is registered in Maharashtra, take the input tax credit of such taxes charged? The answer is no. How can they claim the credit? The one way of doing it is to engage the services of an event organizer. Now, quickly come back to organization of event. Now, an event organizer, if he is appointed, will be taking the services of the hotel and supplying event organization services to GSTPM, in which case, since GSTPM is registered, the place of supply of his service will be location of a recipient, and therefore it will be an interstate supply liable to IGST. Can he take the credit of the CGST and SGST that the hotel will charge him? Yes, he can, because he is Gujarat. Where such event is held outside India, then the provision state that the place of supply will be location of recipient, irrespective of where the event takes place. And if event is held in more than one state, then the place of supply will be based on proportion of the value of service in each state as per the contract. We then move on to goods transportation service. There has been an amendment to this subsection by way of GST Amendment Act of 2018, effective from 1st of February 2019. So, services by way of transportation of goods, including by mail or courier. So, transportation of goods services, including by those services provided by courier agencies, where such services are provided to a registered person, that the services are B2B, then the location of recipient. If I am a business, I am sending out a courier from Mumbai to any other place in India, irrespective of where the courier agency is located, or irrespective of where the goods are handed over to the courier agency, I would still want to claim the credit because these are expenses in the course of my business. Therefore, the location, the place of supply will always be the location of recipient. Where such services are B2C supplies, the location at which goods are handed over for transportation. Therefore, you will realize that where a courier agent is in the business of transporting goods from India to any other place, there is a big business where these courier agencies have tie-ups with larger freight agents such as DHL or FedEx, and then they provide services to people like you and me who may not be registered under GST, who have their relatives in other countries, and they want to send any goods to them. Then wherever such goods are handed over to this courier agent, that will be the location, or that will be the place of supply. Now, before this amendment, all such courier agencies, wherever unregistered persons were giving them any goods for sending it to other countries, were charging CGST and SGST of Maharashtra. After the amendment states where the transportation of goods is to a place outside India, then the place of supply will be place of destination of such goods. Therefore, after this amendment now, in all such cases where an unregistered person or a registered person, irrespective of what the status of the recipient of the service is, where the goods are being delivered outside India or sent outside India, then the place of supply will be such outside country. How does this person file his GSTR1? He has to select, he has to charge IGST, and he has to select the place of supply as other territory. Next, we come to passenger transportation services, where the supply is a B2B supply, then the place of supply will be location of recipient. Where it's a B2C supply, then the place where the passenger embarks for a continuous journey. There is another part to it, subsection 2. If right to passage is given for future use and point of embarkation is not known at the time of issue of right to passage, then the place of supply is to be determined as per the general rules under section 12, subsection 2. So wherever a right to passage for future use is given and embarkation, point of embarkation is not known, what is known as an open ticket, where an open ticket is issued, then the general rules will apply. That means where the supply is a B2B supply, the place of supply will be location of recipient. Where the supply is a B2C supply, then if the address exists on record, it will still be location of recipient. If address does not exist, it will be location of supplier. Services on board a conveyance. Services supplied on board a conveyance such as a vessel, aircraft, train, or motor vehicle. So wherever any services are supplied on board a conveyance, let us take the example of food supplied in a flight. Now, where if Air India flight taking off from Mumbai and going to London is serving food, and assuming that this service of food has been deemed to be a supply of service under Schedule 2, then the place of supply of service shall be the first scheduled point of departure of that conveyance for the journey. What this means is that where a flight takes off from Mumbai and goes to London, irrespective of where the food is served, the place of supply will be the first scheduled point of departure, that is Mumbai. If the flight moves from Mumbai, then goes to Delhi, and then goes to London, even if the food is taken on board at Delhi and served after the flight has left India, still the place of supply will be Mumbai, because that is the first scheduled point of departure of that flight. The last part I'm covering is place of supply services, that is domestic services, is telecommunication services. Telecom services including data transfer, broadcasting, cable, and DTH services provided to any person. So the example of this, these services are your broadband services that you are taking, or your Tata Sky, or Dish TV, or any other services that you're taking. All these services fall under this category for the purposes of determination of place of supply. If it is a fixed line, the place of supply is where the location where the line is installed. If it is a postpaid connection, then the billing address of that postpaid connection is the place of supply. To understand these provisions, these are not very difficult, so I need not explain these in detail. If I have a mobile connection, I am in Mumbai Circle. Again, if an address outside Mumbai will never be given a connection of Mumbai Circle, but for the sake of understanding, if I have a postpaid connection, whatever is my billing address, if it is of Mumbai, the location of supplier is in Maharashtra, place of supply in Maharashtra, that is why your mobile bills all have CGST and SGST. If it is a prepaid connection, if I buy a voucher for which I scratch and then the code comes and then I'm recharging my mobile services, then the location where the prepaid voucher is sold, that will be the place of supply. And prepaid sold through internet, if I go online on the website of Vodafone and then I recharge my prepaid phone, then again, whatever is the billing address for such a transaction, that will be the place of supply. you will obviously be making payment online and there will be a billing address. I'm sorry, that was not the last part. There are two more, banking and insurance services. Now, banking services and other financial services, the place of supply, where location of recipient exists on record, the place of supply will be location of recipient, and where location of recipient does not exist on record, then the place of supply will be location of supplier. I always give an example to understand these provisions, is that in case of banking, it depends on whether the services are provided to account holders or non-account holders. In case of account holders, I will always have their address on record. In case of non-account holder, if I provide certain services, I may not have their address on record. One example that I always give is that if, please bear in mind, this is irrespective of whether the recipient is registered or not. I am located, if I'm registered in Maharashtra, I go to Gujarat and I go to Baroda and I'm in need, urgent need of a draft. I have an account with HDFC. I find a branch of HDFC in Baroda. I go to them. I tell them that I need a demand draft. I fill up a form. I put my account details and they debit my account and they give me a draft. Now, irrespective of where this branch is located, in this case, they have to charge IGST because the location of supplier of service, that branch is located in Gujarat, the location of recipient, my address existing on their record is of Mumbai. That is why they will have to charge IGST. If I do not find a branch of HDFC, I find Bank of Baroda. I go to that branch. I tell them that I need a draft and they agree to give me a draft, issue a draft by taking cash and providing charging certain commission. Now, what tax will they charge on that commission? Do they have my address on record? No. Therefore, it will be the location of supplier. Both are in Gujarat. They will charge CGST and SGST. Insurance services provided to a registered person, the place of supply will be location of such registered person. If they are provided to other than a registered person, then the location of recipient on the records of the supplier. The recipient of insurance services, the address will always be there on the record of the insurance company.
Uh-huh.
Now, to the last part, is there any problem till now? Mahesh, all going well till now?
Yes, Aditya, it's okay.
All right. So I will take up the last part. I will try to finish this in the next 10 minutes and we'll take up questions. The last part deals with place of supply of services where either the location of supplier or the location of recipient is outside India. Please bear in mind, if either of these two are outside India, then you will have to refer to section 13 and not section 12 to determine the place of supply. First part that we need to understand, instead of just learning about the place of supply provisions, because the place of supply provisions you will find in the section 12 as well as 13, I would like to tell you why we are studying this and how to implement these in practical scenarios. So the relevance of section 13, the relevance of place of supply of international services. If you want to treat certain services as export of services, we all know that export of goods or services are zero rated supplies. We need not pay tax on those, or we may be able to claim a refund. Now, in order to treat services as export of services, you must satisfy four conditions. I have only given three here. The fourth one is that you should receive the consideration in convertible foreign exchange. And in case of services, certain relaxations are given in that regard also. However, in order for any services to be export, the conditions that need to be satisfied are that the supplier of service should be located in India, the recipient of service should be located outside India, and the place of supply of service should also fall outside India. So, supplier of service, we already saw the definition, location of supplier of service, location of recipient of service, we also saw the definition, and you will come to section 13. and determine the place of supply of such service. If it falls outside India, only then you can consider these services as export of service. If the place of supply does not fall outside India, then these services cannot be treated as export of services. And that is the main problem that is happening with intermediary services. In the next slide, I'm covering that. Now, in order for any services to be treated as import of services are liable to reverse charge, where the recipient is required to pay tax. So we must know if your client is liable to pay tax under reverse charge, you must first ensure that it is falling under an import of service. Now, in order for a service to be an import of service, it should satisfy the following condition: that the supplier of service should be located outside India, the recipient of service should be located in India, and the place of supply must fall in India. With this understanding and this background in mind, let us try to understand the place of supply of international services. Again, there is a general provision which states that the place of supply of such services will be the location of recipient of services. And if location of recipient is not available in the ordinary course of business, then the place of supply will be location of supplier of service. If I provide any services, let's take a simple case. I am a supplier of service, recipient of service. I am supplying consultancy services through my website. And the person situated in UK or the USA avails these services. Now, the location of recipient is outside India. And this is where the definition of location of recipient of service also gains importance. Please understand this concept through this example. If I provide certain services to a person who is located in USA, if you remember the definition that I covered, it contains multiple clauses where the person is registered, then his place of business will be location of the recipient. If he receives the service at any other place that is a fixed establishment, then that place. Now, if all those things, if a person is outside India, obviously he will not be registered under GST. If it does not fall under any of those clauses, the last clause is that in all other cases, it will be his usual place of residence. Now, in this case, if a person is residing in UK, then the location of recipient of service will be UK. Now, step by step, location of supplier of service, Mumbai, which is in Maharashtra, which is in India. Location of recipient of service is UK, which is outside India. Now, place of supply, if it does not fall under any of the specified services mentioned after this, if it falls under the general clause, then the location of recipient of service will be the place of supply. So my third condition for me to treat it as an export is satisfied. That is, place of supply is also outside India. And then the last part, if he pays to me using pounds or dollars, then all conditions of export will be satisfied. So this is where place of supply gains importance. Now, we come to specific services. Just as we saw under section 12, under section 13 also, there are certain specific services. For such services, you will have to determine place of supply based on these provisions, not on the basis of general provisions. Services supplied in respect of goods that are required to be made physically available by the recipient to the supplier or to a person and acting on behalf of the supplier in order to provide the service. The place of supply is location where the services are actually performed. Let us take an example. I have certain goods of Apple which need repairs. Now let's take an extreme case that the goods cannot be serviced by anyone in India. So a representative from Apple comes from the US to India and supplies those services to me, comes to my residence and services those goods. Now, whether I am required to pay tax under reverse charge, whether this is an import of service, the location of supplier of services is outside India. The location of recipient of service, that is me, is in India. The place of supply is the location where the services are actually performed, that is in India. That is why this is an import of service. Similarly, if the goods are sent by me to the US and they are repaired on and they are sent back to me, in this case, will be still be an import of service? In this case, no, because where the goods are sent out to USA, the place of supply is location where services are actually performed, that is USA. The place of supply is outside India. So one of the three conditions is not being satisfied, and that is why it will not be an import of service. I will not have to pay tax on it under reverse charge. Now, they also say that when the above mentioned services are performed from a remote location by way of electronic means, the location of goods at the time of supply of service. Let's say my laptop needs repairs. Somebody from Apple sitting in the US takes control through electronic means and repairs my laptop. Then they say that location of supplier is outside India, location of recipient is in India, place of supply is location of goods at the time of supply of service, which the goods are located in India, and that is why this will also be an import of service. Goods which are temporarily imported into India for repairs and exported without being put to any other use, then they say the general rule applies. This is a relief given where a supplier in India imports certain goods or brings certain goods in India for the purposes of repair and sends them back. Now, if it were to fall under all any of the above clauses where the services are actually performed, then the place of supply would have been India, and he would not have been able to treat this supply of service as an export because one of the conditions is not getting satisfied, even if he gets his payment in dollars. Therefore, they have stated that where the goods are temporarily imported and then sent back without being put to any use, then the general rule applies, that is the location of recipient will be the place of supply, and that is why the place of supply will be outside India and he will be able to treat it as an export subject to other conditions being satisfied. Next, we come to the performance-based services to an individual where physical presence of the individual or his representative is necessary. Then the place of supply is location where the services are actually performed. I am giving you a case. You can answer these through chat also. Miss A is getting married and she wants to avail the services, and she is hired a world famous hairstylist who is based in Paris for her wedding. She is getting married at a palace in Jaipur, and she is spending that kind of money that she has called upon the services of a hairstylist in Paris. Now the hairstylist comes to Jaipur and provides these services of hairstyling to Miss A for her wedding. My question to you is whether these services are liable to tax, and whether Miss A, who is not a registered person, let's say that she works in an IT company on a salary, is not nowhere concerned with GST liability. Is she liable to pay tax on this and obtain registration? Is anyone going to quickly answer this?
Unmuted.
I will answer.
No. This is not liable to tax.
Yeah.
Somebody has to answer.
Aditya, in my view, no. She is not liable.
Okay.
But
there is one opinion that it is not liable to tax.
No RCA applicable. Service attack RCA.
Is liable.
Yes, please.
Who is liable?
One opinion that is coming as liable. That I am trying to make to place a supply, and I'll also. Thank you. I have also been muted. Yeah, thank you. So, now, first part, is this a performance-based service to an individual where physical presence of the individual is necessary? Yes, it is. Unless that person physically presents herself, Miss A, the hairstylist cannot style her hair. Now, location of supplier of service is outside India. Location of recipient of service, the usual place of residence clause comes into picture again, is in India. Now, where the services are actually performed, the place of supply in terms of 13.3b, since location of supplier is outside India, we'll come to section 13. 13.3b, where the services are actually performed. So the place of supply in this case is Jaipur, that is Rajasthan. Now, the next question is whether services are liable to tax under reverse charge. Yes, the services are liable to tax under reverse charge. If you refer to notification number 10 of 2017, dated 28th of June 2017, integrated tax rate, 10 of 17 integrated tax rate, you will see the very first clause, which states that any person who is availing services, it speaks about any person, it does not speak about a registered person. And if you go to provisions of section 24, if I am not mistaken, which deals with compulsory registration, it clearly states that any person who is liable to tax under reverse charge is liable to obtain registration irrespective of his or her turnover. So somebody in the chat box had stated that turnover below 20 lakhs. When certain cases where it's an interstate supply or where the services or goods are liable to reverse charge, the turnover limit is thrown out of window. So in my opinion, and the answer to this question is that Miss A is liable to pay tax under reverse charge. She has to obtain registration for this purpose and pay tax under reverse charge, and she will have to pay IGST. Moving on. Immovable property related services. It says services directly in relation to an immovable property, including services of experts, accommodation services, grant of rights to use immovable property, etc. The place of supply is place where the immovable property is located or intended to be located. Now, this is now simpler for us to understand because we've already seen in section 12, any services which are intrinsically related, connected to the immovable property, the place of supply is always immovable property. In order for everyone to understand, I have taken two examples. Let's say that Mr. George Clooney of USA wants to purchase a property in Mumbai. For this, he has engaged the services of an estate agent. Now, the services provided by an estate agent, he receives the commission from Mr. George Clooney in US dollars, whether he can treat this as an export of services. Step by step, once again, location of supplier is Maharashtra, that is Mumbai. Location of recipient is USA. Now, the place of supply relating to immovable property is where the property is intended to be located or is already located. That is why it will be Maharashtra. And the third condition of export is not getting satisfied. And that is why this cannot be treated as an export of service. Next, let us take the case of services provided by an architect in Mumbai to his client in Mumbai by way of designing his office in Dubai. Whether this can be treated as an export of service. First and foremost, this will never fall under section 12. Section 13, this will go under section 12 because both the location of supplier as well as the location of recipient is in India. So in this case, we already saw under section 12 that where the property is intended to be located in Dubai, the place of supply is location of recipient, he will charge CGST, SGST. So this is out of the question. What if the client is in Dubai, but the office is to be situated in Mumbai? So I am an architect in Mumbai. My client is in Dubai. He wants to build a property in Mumbai. I am providing services to him in Dubai. Whether this falls under section 12 or section 13, this falls under Section 13 because location of recipient is outside India. Now, 13.4 says that in relation to immovable property services, place of supply will be location of immovable property. Therefore, place of supply will be Maharashtra, and therefore this will not be treated as an export of service. This will have to be CGST and SGST once again. Event organization and admission services. Services by way of admission to or organization of a cultural, artistic, sporting, scientific, educational, or entertainment event or a celebration, conference, etc. Place of supply will be the place where the event is actually held. Just to understand this quickly, I have given two examples. An event management company, Wizcraft, is providing event management services to the Royal Shakespeare Company of the UK for their event held in Delhi. Now, a company of UK is holding an event in Delhi for which they have assigned the event management services to Wizcraft. Wizcraft is located in Mumbai. The event is happening in Delhi and the recipient of service is in the UK. What will be the place of supply? That is my first question. Now, in order to determine place of supply, you will have to come under Section 13 because the recipient is located outside India. Place of supply is where the event is actually being held, that is Delhi. Place of supply is in India. That is why this will not be considered as an export of services because place of supply is not outside India. Then if such services are, so Wizcraft is providing services of event organization and the event is taking place in Sri Lanka. In this case, you come to Section 13, the place of supply is where the event is actually being held, that is Sri Lanka. The place of supply is also outside India, and that is why this can be considered as export of service, provided other conditions are satisfied. Where any service is referred to in 3, 4 or 5, 3 is performance-based services, 4 is immovable property-related services, and 5 is event organization services. Where the place of where these services are provided at more than one location, including a location in taxable territory, the place of supply will be the location in taxable territory. I've given a quick example where the same example I've carried forward, event management services for events being held in Delhi as well as in Sri Lanka. Then the place of supply will be the location in the taxable territory, that is Delhi. And where the supply is spread out in more than one state, then you will have to determine the place of supply in proportion to the value of services provided in each state. Next, we come to a very important part. We come to Section 13.8, which speaks about services provided by a banking company or a financial institution or NBFC to its account holders, intermediary services, and services consisting of hiring of means of transport. Now, I will only highlight the intermediary services part because this is where maximum problems are occurring. The place of supply in this case is stated to be place of the location of supplier of service. What this means, the simple example is a banking company, a bank that is located in Mumbai, which provides a service, an NRI has an account in a bank account in the Mumbai branch. Now these services are being supplied to an NRI, the recipient of services outside India. What will be the place of supply of such services? You will come to Section 13. Any services provided by a banking company to account holders, in case of Section 13, they say that the place of supply is location of supplier of service only. Therefore, the bank will always charge CGST and SGST irrespective of where the account holder is located. Now, intermediary means a broker, an agent, or any other person by whatever name called who arranges or facilitates the supply of goods or services or both between two or more persons, but does not include a person who supplies such goods or services or both on his own account. If I were to give you an example of an intermediary, let's say that I am in Maharashtra. There is a company in Australia which supplies modular kitchens and they ship directly from Australia to any person all over the world. Now I am acting as their agent in India. I provide them the services of developing their market, making people aware of this brand, taking orders from the customers in India, relaying those orders to the Australian company, and the goods are directly supplied by the company to each of the recipient. I do not deal with the goods independently. I only act as their agent. In such cases, I am known as an intermediary. Now, please understand that intermediary services are only under Section 30. That is, for them to be intermediary services and come to Section 13, either the location of the recipient or the recipient. Thank you. So, in such cases, the location of supplier of those goods is Australia. I am supplying services only to the Australian company. I am not supplying any services to the person in India. Therefore, I am the supplier. I am located in India. The recipient is located outside India. The place of supply in such cases, if I want to treat this as an export of service, the place of supply should fall outside India. However, when such services are treated as intermediary services, then the place of supply under Section 13(8) is location of supplier of service, which means I will always have to charge CGST and SGST in case of intermediary services. And it will also not be regarded as an export of service. And that is where the biggest problem is happening. I am not going into the controversies. I just wanted to make the participants aware of what exactly an intermediary is. Now, Section 13, subsection 9, transportation of goods other than by way of mail or courier. The place of supply is destination of such goods. And Section 13, what happens to a courier service in case where the supplier or recipient is outside India, it falls under the general clause. It does not come under a specified clause. Section 13, subsection 10, passenger transportation service where either the recipient or the supplier is outside India, the place of supply is place where the passenger embarks on the conveyance for a continuous journey. I would have liked to explain each of the provision to you by way of examples, but we don't have that much time. Now, services supplied on board a conveyance during the course of a passenger transportation operation, including services intended to be wholly or substantially consumed on board, the place of supply is first scheduled point of departure of that conveyance. Then we come to OIDAR services, online information and database access or retrieval services. The place of supply is location of recipient of service. If I take OIDAR services, now, if I am located in India, I am taking the services of a company which are providing me cloud services. So this is an OIDAR service. Supplier of such services outside India, recipient of services in India, whether I am required to pay tax under reverse charge will depend on whether it is an import of service. For it to be an import of service, the place of supply should fall in India. The provision states that in such a case, the place of supply is the location of recipient of service, that is me, that is in India, and that is why such services are an import service, import of service, and that is why I am required to pay tax on such services that I am taking under reverse charge. In order, last subsection of this says that in order to prevent double taxation or non-taxation, the central government shall have the power to notify any description of service in which the place of supply shall be the place of effective use and enjoyment of service. They say that we, in order to ensure that there is no double taxation, the central government has the power to prescribe any place of supply as the effective use of enjoyment of that service. With this, I end my presentation. I have tried to cover it.
Yeah, thank you.
Shortest time possible. Yes. I now hand over the charge to
Aditya. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Aditya. Actually, subject was so vast that it was very difficult to complete within the short time. But you have dedication and determination. Actually, you are at
Thank you, Arjun.
Still, you managed to do this.
Thank
you, Aditya.
Very grateful to you. Please give big your response to chat.
Thank you, Aditya.
Please, please, you.
Association, I am sharing the PDF Aditya. Of this PPT on this chat. So, those who want.
પ્રોબ્લેમ હોય કોને હોય કાં હોય
Thank you, Aditya. Aditya, we are very grateful to you. Thank you. Thanks a lot. We'll have tomorrow this lecture on ITC. Ashish Shah will be there.
Bolwani Vatsya Badi.
Thank you, Aditya ji.
Hello, Aditya.
The presentation is being shared on the Zoom chat itself.
Aditya? Okay, very good. That's very good. So everybody and even...
It has been shared already.
Aditya, we are having group of this coaching class. So more than 180 members are there already logging. So we will share this with your permission to this group so that they will get that. Because chat, they may not be able to take that. In the WhatsApp group, we'll give that. Will it be all right?
No Aditya? Problem. I will share it. I will share it with Mahesh. And Mahesh can distribute it in the WhatsApp group.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all of you.
Thank you very much. Tomorrow we'll have...
Thanks a lot. Excellent delivery.
Tomorrow we'll have lecture on ITC. And Ashish Shah will be there as a speaker.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, Canadia.
Hello.
Hello, Mahesh.